are listening to the Day by Day podcast for the first week of May, 2017. Welcome to the Day by Day podcast with me, Siobhan. This week, it's a new month, and we'll breathe easier as we try to balance prayer and reason. Now let's start the show.
Winter time has gone and passed, oh, summer time has come at last, oh, we shall sing and dance the day and follow the obvious to bring the May.
Hail, hail, the first of May, oh, for it is the first summer's day, oh, cast your cares and fears away, drink to the old horse on the first of May.
This Monday is May 1st, also known as May Day. While this is not an official holiday in most places, it is a symbolic celebration observed throughout the Northern Hemisphere since ancient times. It is from these ancient spring celebrations that we get many traditions that are still associated with May Day and welcoming the spring. One of these traditions is that of the maypole, though many theories exist as to its exact origin and purpose. In Germany and Austria, the maypole can be traced back to the 16th century. Customarily in these countries, on the night of the last day of April, many young men erect small decorated maypoles in front of the houses of their sweethearts. Some attach a red heart with the name of the girl written on the tree. In Britain, the maypole can be traced back to the mid-14th century. The practice became increasingly popular throughout the ensuing centuries, with the maypoles becoming communal symbols that brought the local community together. Protestantism in the 16th century saw maypoles as immoral and eventually led to their use being outlawed. The Long Parliament's Ordinance of 1644 described maypoles as a heathenish vanity generally abused to superstition and wickedness. In 1660, maypoles were revived and could be seen all around London. The maypole dance is performed by pairs of boys and girls, or men and women, who stand alternately around the base of the pole, each holding the end of a ribbon. In some places, only girls participate in the maypole dance. They weave in and around each other, boys going one way and girls going the other, and the ribbons are woven together around the pole until everyone meets at the base. The earliest known use of the maypole in America occurred in 1628, where William Bradford, governor of New Plymouth, wrote of an incident where a number of servants broke free to create their own colony, setting up a maypole in the center of the settlement, and behaving in such a way as to receive the scorn and disapproval of the nearby colonies. Gathering of wildflowers and making crowns of wildflowers also goes back to ancient times, all to celebrate spring. In Britain, May queens are crowned in various places. She wears white to symbolize purity, and she initiates the May Day festivities. In Oxford, it is traditional to gather below the Great Tower of Magdalen College at 6 a.m. to listen to the college choir sing traditional madrigals as a conclusion to the previous night's celebrations. This is known as May Morning. It is then the tradition for some people to jump off Magdalen Bridge into the River Cherwell. In recent years, the bridge has been closed on May 1st to prevent people from jumping, as the water under the bridge is only about 2 feet deep, and jumping from the bridge has resulted in serious injury in the past. However, there are still people who climb the barriers and leap into the water, and of course, cause injury to themselves. In Durham, a growing tradition is for students of the University of Durham to gather on Prebin's Bridge to see the sunrise and enjoy music, dancing, and even a barbecue breakfast. An understated yet romantic May 1st tradition comes from France. On May 1st, 1561, King Charles IX received a Lily of the Valley as a lucky charm. He decided to offer a Lily of the Valley each year to the ladies of the court. At the beginning of the 20th century, it became custom to give a sprig of Lily of the Valley on May 1st, a symbol of springtime and a wish for happiness. It is said that whoever finds a Lily of the Valley with 13 small bells will be particularly lucky. On this day and this day only, the government permits individuals and workers' organizations to sell the flowers tax-free. In Greece, May Day celebrations consist of the preparation of a flower wreath from wildflowers with a background of green leaves. The wreath is hung on the entrance to the family home or on a balcony and remains there until Midsummer Night, which falls on or around June 24th. On that night, the flower wreaths are set alight in bonfires known as St. John's fires, and young people leap over the flames, consuming the flower wreaths. This custom seems really dangerous and has been dying out. While it has officially been spring since March 20th, in many places, the weather is not quite warm enough to celebrate spring until now. And so, May marks celebrations of spring and the rapid approach of summer. Many other May 1st celebrations exist, including Beltrán, Walpurgis, and Ley Day, but I'm going to save those for the future so I can really get into the history. In the late 19th century, May Day was chosen as International Workers' Day, but I'm going to save that specific observance for a future episode as well. This Tuesday is World Asthma Day, an annual event organized by the Global Initiative for Asthma, or GINA. The day is meant to improve asthma awareness and care around the world. The first World Asthma Day was held in 1998. This year's theme is Better Air, Better Breathing. The World Health Organization and U.S. National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute are partners in supporting World Asthma Day. The World Health Organization defines asthma as a chronic disease characterized by recurrent attacks of breathlessness and wheezing, which vary in severity and frequency from person to person. During an asthma attack, the lining of the bronchial tube swells, causing the airways to narrow and reducing the flow of air into and out of the lungs. The airways are tubes that carry air into and out of your lungs. People who have asthma have inflamed airways. The inflammation makes the airways swollen and very sensitive. The airways tend to react strongly to certain inhaled substances. When the airways react, the muscles around them tighten. This narrows the airways, causing less air to flow into the lungs. The swelling also can worsen, making the airways even narrower. Cells in the airways might make more mucus than usual. Mucus is a sticky, thick liquid that can further narrow the airways. This chain reaction can result in asthma symptoms. The strongest risk factors for developing asthma are exposure to indoor allergens such as house dust mites in bedding, carpets and stuffed furniture, pollution and pet dander, outdoor allergens such as pollen and molds, tobacco smoke, and chemical irritants in the workplace. Failure to recognize and avoid triggers that lead to a tightened airway may result in an asthma attack, respiratory distress, and even death. Asthma triggers can include cold air, extreme emotional arousals such as anger or fear, and physical exercise. Even certain medications can trigger asthma. Most asthma-related deaths occur in low and lower middle-income countries. According to the latest World Health Organization estimates that were released in December 2016, there were 383,000 deaths due to asthma in 2015. Asthma cannot be cured, but appropriate management can control the disorder and enable people to enjoy a good quality of life. Short-term medications are used to relieve symptoms. Medications such as inhaled corticosteroids are needed to control the progression of severe asthma and reduce asthma exacerbation and deaths. People with persistent symptoms must take long-term medication daily to control the underlying inflammation and prevent symptoms and exacerbations. It is estimated that 235 million people currently suffer from asthma, nearly 25 million people in the United States alone, and more than 6 million of those are children. More than 10.5 million school days are lost each year due to asthma, and it is responsible for nearly 2 million hospital visits in the U.S. each year. The Asthma and Allergy Foundation of America is a great resource for asthma education. They want to train people affected by asthma to learn about research. If you have asthma, or you're the parent or caregiver of someone with asthma, you can learn about the different types of research and how research can help people make future healthcare decisions during their interactive training sessions. Just contact Sarah at aafa.org for more information.
It's said that prayer can move mountains. Well, it certainly moved the hearts and minds of Americans in their times of trial and helped them to achieve a society that, for all its imperfections, is still the envy of the world and the last best hope of mankind. And just as prayer has helped us as a nation, it helps us as individuals. In nearly all our lives, there are moments when our prayers and the prayers of our friends and loved ones help to see us through and keep us on the right path. In fact, prayer is one of the few things in this world that hurts no one and sustains the spirit of millions.
That was President Reagan in 1982 speaking to the nation about prayer. There are many official days of prayer throughout the world and for different religions. This Thursday is the National Day of Prayer in the U.S. This is an annual day of observance held on the first Thursday of May, designated by the United States Congress, when people are asked to turn to God in prayer and meditation. Each year since its inception, the president has signed a proclamation encouraging all Americans to pray on this day. Days of fasting and prayer have been established in the U.S. since 1775, and most presidents have issued annual or special occasion proclamations for a National Day of Prayer. The modern law formalizing the National Day of Prayer as an annual observance was enacted in 1952. This year's theme is inspired by Daniel 9:19. For your great name's sake, hear us, forgive us, heal us. The National Day of Prayer is celebrated by Americans of many religions, including Christians of many denominations, including Protestant and Catholic, as well as Sikhs, Muslims, Hindus, and Jews, reflecting the demographics of the United States. On the National Day of Prayer, many Americans assemble in prayer in front of courthouses, as well as in houses of worship, such as churches, mosques, synagogues, and temples. Luncheons, picnics, and music performances revolving around praying for the nation are also popular observances. As you can imagine, the practice of a National Day of Prayer has raised controversy among those who oppose the combining of government and religion. In response, the National Day of Reason was started in 2003 by the American Humanist Association and the Washington Area Secular Humanists. According to its founders, the National Day of Prayer violates the First Amendment of the United States Constitution because it asks federal, state, and local government entities to set aside tax dollar-supported time and space to engage in religious ceremonies. According to the National Day of Reason website, the goal of this effort is to celebrate reason, a concept all Americans can support, and to raise public awareness about the persistent threat to religious liberty posed by government intrusion into the private sphere of worship. In 2005, the New York City-based Center for Atheism began to strongly advocate for observers of the National Day of Reason to celebrate in a positive manner. They decided to donate blood as a group in order to make a public statement about the life-affirming ideas of non-believers. There are many organized charitable activities to recognize the National Day of Reason, such as blood, food, and clothing drives, while others recognize the day by organizing protests against the National Day of Prayer. Some groups have sought legal action against the National Day of Prayer. In 2011, the unconstitutionality of the day was unsuccessfully challenged in court by the Freedom From Religion Foundation, while others see room for both a National Day of Prayer and a National Day of Reason, believing the two do not have to oppose each other. You can find events near you for whichever side of the coin you're on by visiting nationaldayofprayer.org and nationaldayofreason.org. The two websites look rather similar, by the way. That's it for this week. I'll be back next week. Until then, remember to make each day count.